So let me start by introducing myself. I'm Jennifer Widom. I'm the Dean of the School of Engineering, and I'm really pleased to welcome all of you to the 125th anniversary of the founding of the Electrical Engineering Department, which, if you do the calculation, is just a few years after the founding of Stanford itself. It's great to have all of you here today. Thanks for coming. And thanks for whatever part you played in the amazing things this department has accomplished over those 125 years. And I'm personally particularly delighted to be opening the event today because in addition to being the Dean of Engineering and a computer scientist, I am also a member of the Electrical Engineering faculty. So I have firsthand experience in what an amazing department this is in so many different ways, and I'm going to mention a few of those. For starters, there's the rich history of the department and the department's really remarkable place in making history. You'll learn about the history of the department in some of the talks today, I think starting with Stephen Boyd right after me. But it's no exaggeration, I would say, that Stanford, Silicon Valley, and the world as we know it wouldn't be the same if it weren't for Stanford's EE department. Then there are the people. Not that deans are extra important people, but it does happen that if you include myself, 6 of the 10 deans of the School of Engineering had appointments in EE. There were the late Fred Terman and Joseph Pettit, and others you'll be hearing from today, Jim Gibbons, John Hennessy, and Jim Plummer, and I know we're all looking forward to their talks. Electrical engineering is also home to hundreds of students a year, many of them receiving undergraduate or graduate degrees from the department, but many students across Stanford also take EE classes. They want to understand the discipline and the technologies that will benefit them in their own field and their own career. So for all the students who are in the audience today, welcome. EE has thousands of alumni who have gone on to successful careers in academia and industry, and some of those alums will be speaking today. Many others are in the audience, so welcome to all the alums in the audience for being here, for supporting EE and Stanford Engineering, and thank you for your contributions to the field. And EE is home to an amazing group of faculty who are doing work across a wide variety of areas. And you'll be hearing some bragging about the many awards and accolades those faculty have received over the years. I'd like to touch briefly on the research that goes on in electrical engineering. So as many of you know, at Stanford, we're very proud of the fact that we have very low barriers to collaboration. And this department, both at the present time and throughout its history, I would say is a great showcase for Stanford's collaborative spirit. EE faculty collaborate not just across the School of Engineering, but across the entire university. They currently have joint projects with all 8 other departments in the School of Engineering, and with many, if not all, of Stanford's 6 other schools. Faculty are doing groundbreaking research in areas that are making headway on the world's important challenges. And here are some of those research areas. I was given a fairly comprehensive list, but the breadth is incredible. So interdisciplinary biomedical research. That includes photonics, biomedical devices, sensors, and systems. Interdisciplinary research in energy, including energy-efficient hardware systems, integrated circuits, and power electronics. Research at the forefront of information technology, including energy-efficient and robust hardware systems, software-defined networks, secure distributed systems, data science, integrated circuits, and power electronics. Research in semiconductor devices, integrated circuits, and electronic systems engineering. And research related to information systems and science, including biomedical imaging, optical communications, wireless communications and networks, multimedia communications, the internet, energy systems, transportation systems, computational imaging and display systems, financial systems, That was a long list, and I probably left a few things out. The breadth of the work that goes on in the department is amazing and, importantly, touches, I'd say, every aspect of society and our lives. So you'll hear more about some specific work later today. I'm sure it'll be inspirational, will make you optimistic about the future of research in this department and across the university through so many collaborations. So let me conclude. Stanford's Electrical Engineering Department has an incredible heritage. It's thriving today with a fantastic community of faculty, students, alumni, and staff. And thank you to the staff for organizing this fantastic event. And I hope all of you will take the opportunity to get to know one another. I saw a lot of that happening already. There will be plenty of chances throughout the day. And there's a bright future ahead for EE. So before I hand the mic over to Stephen Boyd, just once again, congratulations on 125 years, and I'm eager to see what the next century brings.
Thanks, Jennifer. Thanks for your welcome. Welcome everybody to Stanford and to our 125 celebration. So I'm Stephen Boyd. I'm the current chair of the department. Actually, just for the historical record, there have been 23 so far. So actually, I'll give you some of the numbers later for like how many total graduates we have, things like that. So we've actually got 11 great talks lined up for the celebration from a diverse array of speakers. Some alums, some faculty, and on very diverse topics. So some are going to be technical, some historical. In fact, the real history is not going to be from me, Jennifer. It's actually going to be from Tom Lee and from Jim Gibbons. I'll give you a taste, just a taster for the history. Some will be retrospective. Some will be looking forward. And I think one is going to be about looking around walls. Gordon, is that correct? Yes, it is. Okay, so yes, we're going to have a talk about looking around walls. So I've only got 10 minutes for this intro, so I'm going to go fast. Jennifer, you said that there would be a lot of bragging. I actually removed the bragging because even under the most extreme compression, it was not compatible with a 10-minute talk. So I'm sorry. Okay. So anyway, I thought also it's kind of like, you know, we all know this. So back to the beginning. This is the first commencement that had someone listed as someone getting a degree in electrical engineering. This was Lucian Gilmore, was our first graduate. That's 1894. I'm just gonna go through a bunch of like very cool slides from the archives just for fun. This is Harris Ryan's high voltage lab. Now, some of you might know that since about, I don't know, 1960s and well now, we actually haven't done that much in power systems in our department. So now we have Juan Rivas. You're going to hear from him later. We have Sarbanti Chowdhury. But actually, unfortunately, they don't do stuff this cool. That was a hint, Sarbanti. So I know you're just getting your lab set up. So Juan, is Juan here? Juan really could do this. He just won't. Anyway, okay. Now, fast forwarding, we get to the microwave and traveling wave tube era. So this is Russell and Sigurd Varian with a klystron. So this is if you don't know some of the history. I mean, there's an enormous amount of history for your department. I just randomly picked some cool things with good photos. So here's a wonderful photo. This is alleged. I don't know if it's really true, but this is alleged to be. It is certain that is Jim Gibbons in the middle. He is holding a semiconductor. It's alleged to be Stanford's first semiconductor. I will let him confirm if that's actually correct or not. Jim, is it? It is. It really is. That really is. Okay, that's pretty cool. Yeah. Okay. It doesn't matter with these old photos. We can make up all sorts of stories, and it. It really doesn't matter if it's true or not, but it's nice if it's true. Okay. Here's another icon for our department. So that is a very young Ron Bracewell to the left. I think that array of dishes is gone now in 1961. So the dish, of course, is still there. All right, here's one. In the middle is Ted Hoff, Bernie Widrow's student, holding up 1971 Intel 4004 processor. So that was the first microprocessor. That's pretty cool. The photo, by the way, is from 1996, not 1971. This is great. It's Ralph Merkel, Marty Hellman, and Whit Diffie. I like it mostly just for Marty's haircut. And I don't know what they're doing, but I think, I mean, they're looking at some computer printout, and I don't know, would you look at a computer printout to know about, you know, public key cryptography? But let's just say they're doing public key cryptography. How about that? We'll just, I don't know. Okay. Next one is, we fast forward. This is Paul Raj behind in front of a whiteboard with some MIMO explanation. I thought it's a good photo. And here is Andrea Goldsmith. It's actually a low-res photo, and you can't quite see Andrea. There she is, low-res, but blown up. And I believe I'm not quite sure if she's off the ground or not. Anyway, this is Andrea. She actually rang the bell to open NASDAQ that morning, which is pretty cool. What I'm going to do now is actually just tell you some basic facts about the department and actually some cumulative and historical numbers, right? So we'll start with, we've had in total 216 faculty members, 66 current. I mean, it depends how you do the accounting. I'm rounding up. So if someone has a half appointment, I'm counting them as an EE person. We have granted 4,200 BS degrees. That was 50, let's say, last year. Little over, 12,500 MS degrees. That's kind of a lot, actually. And 492 engineer degrees. Some of you might not know what that is. That is a degree that we had for, I don't know, maybe like almost 100 years or something like that, which we have phased out. It's something between a master's and a PhD. And we've granted, coming up on 4,000 PhDs. So. And we're kind of right now graduating on the order between 65, 85 a year. So a couple of years from now, we're going to hit 4,000, which is kind of cool. But here's a breakdown. This is actually the full accounting of how many faculty there were in our department. It's actually kind of cool. It goes back to 1892. By the way, this was collated by our staff. This is incredible that you couldn't ask someone at Stanford, like, how many faculty were there. You actually had to go back to the newspaper, actually, the microfiche, and read stuff and find out who was appointed and not appointed. So here it is. And it's actually kind of cool. You can see a couple of things right after around 1946 or so. You have the establishment of federally supported research. There's another inflection point, which I think we could label Sputnik or something like that. But actually, after that, what's kind of shocking is even on a 125-year timescale, it looks kind of stable, right? So it's kind of it's interesting. Oh, I guess there's a whole lot more emerita right now, so that's growing. So, yeah, I didn't say anything about it. That's great. So, okay, aha. I'm going to show this just because today is a day we should be celebrating, and I think, you know, it's a wonderful department. We've done a lot of things, but this is just to acknowledge that we have a whole lot more to do. And I thought it's important, you know, don't worry, the rest of the day, we're going to be celebrating. This is kind of a shocking thing that shows, like, the fraction of women. It's kind of what you think it is. So I don't know, I'd be wonderful to see what this looks like when we get to 250. I don't know what it's going to look like. I should have made a projection or something like that. But anyway, okay. Here's the number of degrees we conferred, and once again, you see the two inflection points. One is right around when you had federally sponsored research starting up, and then another one is Sputnik. I don't know what that 1984 jump is. I do know that the precipitous drop right after 1984 coincided with my arriving at Stanford. So I don't know. I don't know what if those are related or anything. They're probably just correlated. Okay. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to close by just, I'm going to mention very briefly just some cool new things, because I was speaking to a couple people beforehand who hadn't even seen our, quote, new building, which is from 1999. If you haven't, you should go see it. It's very cool. But I thought I'd just mention some critical things for people who are part of the family but just simply haven't been around for a while. So the first one is the Quals goes away after 62 years. Yeah, so Yeah, and so I'd actually like to issue a formal apology to anyone in the audience who was subjected to the previous quals. So please accept my formal apology. So actually, after we did this, I had to go talk to a bunch of students, and I said, oh, hey, if there was like a university and they had this horrendous quals, and let's suppose you were in the last cohort of people who had to take it, how would you feel? And the student said, what university is that? I said, you don't know it. That's another, anyway, but I apologized to them. And I told them, look, from now on, they could go out and they'd meet people, and they would say, well, did you take the new quals or the old quals? And they'd say the old ones, and they could be proud, because the new ones are, okay, fine. All right, so next year we are headed into our new building. We're going to do some renovations, and some of them are pretty cool. They're not huge from an architectural point of view, but they're going to be, I think, really cool from a cultural point of view. We're actually going to redo our basement, which, if you have been it, you know, is something like kind of a dungeon or something, depressing dungeon. But we're gonna redo that. It's going to be all glass walls and lots of robotics labs. And on the first floor, we're going to open everything up. It's going to be it's all open, and there's going to be, that's where our maker lab is going to be. So, presumably in a year or so, when you're at Bites having a coffee, you're going to be sitting across from like laser cutters and things like that. So I just think that's really cool. So that's what we're up to. Another one. These are just random new things I think some people might be interested in. Last year we ran our first. It was completely unofficial. Fortunately, no one was killed. That's good, because I would have been in a lot of trouble. Actually, Andrea and I would have been in a lot of trouble if anybody had been. So we did our first. What's that? Oh, I'm about to tell him. So we had a pilot last year. We took a bunch of scenes. Tom Lee was there. A bunch of us were there. It was a wonderful trip. There was a special event during the trip, and that would be that we were directly on the path of a super typhoon. So that was a sort of an extra experience, especially after it was determined that none of the students had been killed, which none were, by the way, just so you know. But highlights there would be Tom Lee leading a tour of Huachang Bay, which would be like, I don't know. If you haven't done that, we may open it up to alumni at some point. First, we're going to establish it and then maybe make it open to alumni. But trust me, you want to do that if you want to go on a tour of Huachang Bay with Tom Lee, for sure. Okay, so that's my quick overview. We've got a bunch of talks all set up. I think we might even be on time, or a little bit, or no, just a little bit off. We're not so bad. So, okay, so thanks, everyone. For questions, I was told that there will be microphones circulating or something, and you should use them or something like that. So, good. So at this point, I'm going to turn it back over to Jennifer.
Thanks, Stephen, for that great talk. And thank you for the amazing job you're doing as department chair. So you can see the department's in great hands. It's 23rd department chair, is that what you said? And there's a few others out here who have also set the stage for the department doing so well. And I enjoy working with Stephen, as you can tell. He's a lot of fun.